Shakespeare's timelessness is in his timeliness.
Why is Shakespeare so important and so unique? Well, one of the extraordinary things about him is his understanding of human nature. Way before his time, way before psychiatrists and psychologists, he understood what was going on in people's hearts and minds.
Whatever it is that he did in terms of plumbing relationships, psychological, you know, insides of characters, are continually renewable in the mouths of actors, and they always change as history moves on, as times change. The plays seem to speak in a different way.
Twelfth Night, or What You Will, Shakespeare's comedy from 1602, tells the story of a love triangle between a handsome young Duke, Orsino, Olivia, the woman he longs for, and Viola, the girl disguised as a boy who is their go-between.
She's been shipwrecked and has landed up in Illyria, and she's been separated from her brother Sebastian, whom she thinks she saw drown. And she's a woman alone in this strange land, so Viola lands up dressing as a boy and serving Count Orsino.
What dost thou know?
Too well what love women to men may owe. In faith, they are as true of art as we. My father had a daughter loved a man. As it might be, perhaps, were I a woman, I should, your lordship.
She's in love with her master, Orsino, and Orsino is in love with Olivia, who's his female counterpart in this world. And Olivia is in love with Viola because she thinks Viola is a man. So Viola is caught in between these two very powerful figures and empathizes with both and feels for both and is madly in love with one and doesn't know how to tell the other that her love is entirely misplaced.
She's one of those great, wise Shakespearean girls. They're girls. They're not really women. And they're wiser than all the men. They have these deep instincts about how to perceive people around them.
Twelfth Night is about love. And it's about finding yourself through love, coming to an understanding of yourself and what you want in a partner.
The festival of Twelfth Night is the 12th day of Christmas. Twelfth Night in the Renaissance was probably the biggest and most important of the 12 days of Christmas. It dwarfed Christmas itself. It was the last day of the holiday. It would have been celebrated with a lot of drinking.
It was a time of zany celebration.
The whole concept of order is a little bit dislocated.
It's called Twelfth Night, so it's really about the end of a period of festivity, the Christmas season in the Christian year.
The festival of Twelfth Night, marked by feasting and drinking and a world momentarily turned upside down, was a final moment of wild celebration before the return to work that marked the end of the holiday. This spirit of excess informs almost every passage of Shakespeare's play.
It begins with one of the most famous little overtures in Shakespeare. If music be the food of love, play on, give me excess of it, that surfeiting the appetite may sicken and so die. And while it's beautiful to listen to, he's asking for so much music that he gets killed by it. He commits suicide by the excess of too much beauty in his life. That's what he wants. And that sets the tone for these excessive characters who are too drunk, they're always partying, they need to calm down, they need to grow up, they need to see life as it really is.
My name is David Schramm. I play the character of Sir Toby Belch. He exists as a sort of a counterpoint to another character in the play called Malvolio. Malvolio is very puritanical and very uptight and very, you know, goes by the rules. And Toby Belch represents the reverse. It's excess, drinking, food, staying up all night.
In England in the early 17th century, there was an influential religious movement, Puritanism, which frowned upon merrymaking and thought all forms of pleasure to be inherently sinful.
This play was a rebuke to the Puritans. Puritanism in this play is made fun of in the character of Malvolio, the steward to Olivia.
He wants to keep the world in order. He believes that this is the way things should be done. He's not a deep man. I think it's about order. I think chaos terrifies him. I think Malvolio's fatal flaw is his self-love and his inability to see anything else but his own view.
In this play, Twelfth Night, you have really two extremes. Extremes are not good, but it's better than being the Puritan refuser of merriment, the person who says, I will not play, and you can't either.
Between these two extremes, Shakespeare attempts to find the balance.
Here he basically is saying, you've got to grow up. If you want to participate in life, you have got to stop acting as if life is a party. It's time to live a wiser life and stop being excessive and be who you are, which is supposedly an adult. And it's about the beauty of growing up. It's about the intensity of growing up.
Shakespeare's comedies are all of them romantic comedies that deal with marriage. They don't always end in marriage, but marriage becomes the end, aim, and goal for him, which is the way you end a comedy, because comedy is about continuity. Comedy is about moving from one generation to another. The younger generation gets to take over. Teenagers grow into adults, and then they have their own families and marriage.
It's a play that's so rich because it's the last of his sort of witty comedies. From here on out, he gets much darker. And the next play he writes is Julius Caesar, and then after that he writes Hamlet. So this is, in a sense, his farewell to the great witty comedies, As You Like It and Much Ado About Nothing. And as such, it's a kind of culmination of all of his comic writing.
The source of much of the comedy in Twelfth Night is Festi, a classic Shakespearean clown.
Festi, as the representative of the festival world, is probably the voice in this play, the clown, that comes closest to speaking for the Shakespearean point of view.
Festi in Twelfth Night is the fool, but he is a wise fool.
He's not a sort of ha-ha fool. I mean, he's a man of irony and wit and experience. He's a sort of wise, sad fool.
He is, as he puts it in the play, the corrupter of words.
Take the fool away.
Do you not hear, fellows?
Take away the lady.
Go to, you are a dry fool, I'll know more of you. Besides, you grow dishonest.
Two faults, Madonna, that drink and good counsel will amend. Even though Twelfth Night is called a comedy, it's also very melancholic as well.
It's a strange play because it seems to be a lot of slapstick, a lot of funny stuff. But really, there's a lot of darkness in it, and there's some cruelty.
In all of his great comedies, there is an underlying strain of sadness and of harsh reality. His leavening of the dark with the light, sadness with happiness, is what constantly keeps the play sort of shifting and changing and always fluidly alive.
In Twelfth Night, Shakespeare employs songs as a melancholy counterpoint to the comedy.
Festi, when he's asked to sing a song, but it's normally a song that is a little bit of yearning, of melancholy, and it heightens the main character's mood.
Oh, stay in here, your true love's coming, that can sing both high and low. Trip no further, pretty sweeting, journey's ending, lovers meeting, every wise man's son doth know.
In addition to the love triangle plot, Twelfth Night has a second plot, or subplot, involving Sir Toby Belch and his friends playing a cruel practical joke on Malvolio.
Maria comes up with an idea to trick Malvolio. They write a letter that they set up for him that he finds, and he thinks it is a love letter to him from Olivia. He reads this letter, and because of his fatal flaw, his self-love, he believes it's true, that she does indeed love him.
The forged love letter contains outlandish instructions to Malvolio on how to win Olivia's love. The effect of following these instructions closely is that Malvolio appears to others as if he has gone mad.
Go hang yourselves all. You are idle, shallow things.
I am none of your element. You shall know more of this later.
Is it possible?
They shut him up in a dark house, which was a place reserved for madmen. He doesn't really deserve that. He's a pompous fool. He's an affected ass. But the retribution is quite cruel.
The letter, in fact, was a counterfeit. And everything he believed to be true is, in fact, not true. And he is devastated. And he then swears revenge upon the house, upon everyone, and makes his final exit.
The comic choice is the choice to re-embrace. The comic choice is the choice to acknowledge that we are all imperfect, that life is brief, that a lot of it is sad, and that we might as well celebrate it with pleasure, with music, dance, enjoyment, drama, merriment, while we have a chance. In this play, a little bit unusually in the comedies, that revenge motif, however, takes a real central place.
Directing Shakespeare it requires a different set of muscles, because the entire meaning and feeling of the play, all of its emotional impact, resides in its language and nowhere else.
Shakespeare's language is hard. And the comic language is the hardest of all, because comedy belongs to its own culture.
I think the language and its intent and its intelligence and emotional being, combining all that with a text that's very complex, that's the big challenge in Shakespeare.
So much of the language is written in iambic pentameter, which takes a great deal of control for actors to speak.
It's been likened to the heartbeat because it goes ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. That's a regular line. Now, like the heartbeat, it can change and get very erratic according to the intention of the actor, the mood, the scene, what's going on, the emotional temperature. So it doesn't always just go ba-boom, 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 ba-boom. Sometimes it goes ba-boom or boom-boom in the middle of a line. They're signals to the actor that something's changing, something's happening. But you have to be careful, because all this sounds very voicey and Shakespearean, and it shouldn't be that way at all. It's really got to sound as if the speech is their own and as if they are really talking to people. So it requires a delicate balance.
Shakespeare, it's really hard to read. I find reading Shakespeare, and I'm British, really difficult to read. But when you hear it, when you hear it spoken and you see it, it enlivens. It has a whole different level of meaning.
Working with Shakespeare's language it's wonderful, but it also is very tricky. It presents its own sets of problems. For instance, in just making the language clear to the audience. The joy of it, though, is once you do that, once you really have the words inside of you, they are just so juicy. There's just so much mileage you can have in just saying one or two words. And it becomes kind of an athletic event for your tongue, in a way.
You have to have a great capacity of breath and be very agile, both in your mind and in your body, to be able to keep up with what he is saying on the page.
Many phrases and words are totally unfamiliar to us. So how does an actor make that clear? Firstly, I think by tone of voice. You can do a great deal by the way you say a word to make it clear in that context. Also, of course, that's backed up maybe by some physical movement, whatever it might be. And through both the physical and the vocal, hopefully, you can transmit the meaning. That's another thing that makes them so extraordinary. There's no one way. There's no one way to speak a line. There's no one way to play a scene. There's no one way to create a character because his canvas is so vast.
Shakespeare wrote primarily for the Globe Theatre in London, a venue that employed almost no scenery and minimal props.
When you're designing a Shakespeare play, you're more likely to need to remember what the original plays were done on, which was really a very plain but serviceable stage that at one moment could be the Forest of Arden, and at the next moment it's a battlefield, and at the next moment it's someone's bedchamber. And it's, you know, that all of these things are fluidly happening, one scene toppling on top of another. You can't take time to change the scenery.
I think that you have to design an environment that allows the action to be supported. And for Shakespeare, that often means having a lot of entrances and a lot of exits and creating an environment, a space that allows for a heightened degree of fluidity. We really treated the space as an installation of elements that are both indoor and outdoor, supporting the fact that the play moves very seamlessly between a lot of different worlds and different locations in Illyria.
Costuming is really important in helping an actor on stage tell a story. And we've often referred to our version of Twelfth Night as being a snow globe with all these pieces that has been shook up and come back down because the characters land in this world called Illyria, which is a little contrary to what the regular world is. It's like a delirious state. It's a sort of a little bit mystical and a little bit sort of out of the ordinary and not your regular run-of-the-day existence. What's exciting about this particular show is we've decided there aren't any rules, and that the rules are that it's a collective mess and there's kind of a chaos visually happening. Actually, all the shapes are completely cross-period and a bit sort of contradictory or juxtaposed.
This great hope in the play that's allied with passion. I feel like it's always about people making a choice to love in the face of death and despair and darkness and winter.
And I think what's really wonderful about it is these stories are timeless. They're archetypes. They deal with really regular things that we have on a day-to-day basis. Like, what does it mean to fall in love? And what does it mean to like a boy? And what does it mean to like a girl? And what's interesting about this has been happening for centuries. And it's exciting to hear that story told today and know that what you're going through as a human being has been gone through by so many other people. And that connects us to a greater story and a greater community in life.
Twelfth Night is about perception. How you perceive things one way, but indeed they're another way. And how the only way to really succeed in life is balance. The good, the bad, the excessive, the puritanical, those things all must balance in your life.
This play is about celebrating and about the end of celebrating. It's about joyfulness, and it's about realizing that joy comes to an end, and that something deeper and wiser has to come out of that movement.
Wish you 10 times more. Soul kick, a soul kick.